Random House Audio presents The Secrets of the FBI by Ronald Kessler. Read for you by Michael Bybee. Prologue. It was Christmas Day, just before noon. The turkey was in the oven, and the aroma was beginning to fill the house when Arthur M. Art Cummings, the second, received a call on his BlackBerry. The FBI command center told him to call back on his secure phone. When he did, he learned that a passenger aboard Northwest Airlines Flight 253, which was on its final approach to Detroit from Amsterdam, had tried to detonate explosives as the airliner entered U.S. airspace. As the FBI's Executive Assistant Director for National Security, Cummings, 50, ran both counterterrorism and counterintelligence for the Bureau. He was the official directly responsible for detecting and thwarting terrorist plots and espionage by other countries. Few in the U.S. government knew as many secrets. For Cummings, hunting terrorists was a battle of wits. He was the predator, the terrorists his prey. Had a terrorist eluded him? Could he trust the information he was getting? Had he missed a clue? These were the things that kept him awake at night as he directed the FBI's transformation from an agency that emphasizes prosecutions to one that focuses on prevention of plots before they happen. To ping in on terrorists, Cummings talked daily with Tactical Operations, a super-secret unit of FBI break-in artists who conduct court-authorized burglaries in homes, offices, and embassies to plant hidden microphones and video cameras and snoop into computers. Besides terrorists, the targets may be mafia figures, corrupt members of Congress, spies, or intelligence officers of Russia and China. When conducting covert entries, TacOps tranquilizes guard dogs and may stage fake traffic accidents, traffic stops, or utility breakdowns to waylay occupants and security personnel. To conceal agents as they defeat locks and alarm systems, it creates false fronts to houses and fake bushes that hide agents. If caught breaking in, TacOps agents are in danger of being shot by occupants who think they are burglars. Besides hunting down Al-Qaeda, Cummings had to contend with bureaucratic rivalries. The New York City police broke a promise to the FBI and jumped the gun in the case of Najibullah Zazi, who had plotted to blow up New York City subways for Al-Qaeda. The Department of Homeland Security could not manage its own immigration responsibilities, yet it tried to become involved in a range of counterterrorism decisions that were the purview of the FBI. Then there was the Office of the Director of National Intelligence, an agency that often got in the way and produced little of value to the FBI. In addition to bureaucratic infighting, Cummings had to deal with requests that could compromise the independence of the FBI. After announcing its decision to try Khalid Sheikh Mohammed in New York City, the Justice Department asked Cummings to prepare an assessment of the security threat that such a trial would pose there. Cummings resisted. He figured such an assessment from the FBI would be used for political purposes by both Democrats and Republicans. In any case, he thought the New York idea, which he believed was irresponsible, would never be carried out. The effort by Obama administration officials to publicly use euphemisms such as man-caused disasters to refer to terrorism, or to avoid the terms Islamist or jihadist in describing the enemy, galled Cummings. Terrible, terrible is the way Cummings described those ideas. Of course Islamists dominate the terrorism of today, he says. On the other hand, Cummings had no problem with the desire of both the Obama and Bush administrations to read terrorists their rights. He believed that in most cases, the FBI could obtain the intelligence it needed to stop future plots by remaining within the framework of the legal system, including by administering Miranda warnings. The trick was to confront suspects before they were in custody, give them incentives to talk, and establish rapport. Cummings himself was a genius at getting bad people to incriminate themselves. A master of eye contact, Cummings has a receding hairline that emphasizes the intensity of his gaze. His magnetic blue eyes direct energy toward his listener. It's all about parrying with the adversary, Cummings says. How many crumbs did he leave, and how many can I pick up? How do I get to the answer? How do I get to what's really happening? There are so many different ways to do it, but the best way by far is sitting across the table from someone. The best thing is when you're sinking your fangs into his neck and he's smiling while you do it because you convince him that what he's doing is in his best interest, when in fact it absolutely is not. Having been told about the Christmas Day bomber, Cummings grabbed a Snickers bar and a Coke. That would be his Christmas dinner in 2009. His wife, Ellen, and three teenagers would enjoy turkey and cranberry sauce by themselves. Cummings was now in charge of the case of Umar Farouk Abdulmutallab, one of the FBI's most controversial and potentially most damaging terrorist cases. Cummings jumped in his FBI car, a Dodge Charger. He turned on the sirens and the flashing blue and red lights and raced toward FBI headquarters. Chapter 1. TacOps. When breaking into homes and offices to plant bugging devices, TacOp agents try to avoid using rear doors. Since they are rarely used, rear doors could be booby-trapped. So when TacOps agents needed to plant bugs in a Philadelphia electronic supply company that was a front for an organized crime drug gang's hangout, they decided to walk in through the front door. Agents decided the best time for entry would be between midnight and 2 in the morning. After that, trash collectors began their pickups and could see agents breaking in. The only problem was that across the street was a bar with outside seating. Patrons of the bar would spot the FBI team defeating the locks and disarming the alarm system at the front door. So TacOps agents borrowed a city bus and rode to the electronics supply company. They parked the bus at the front door and pretended that the bus had broken down. As the FBI agent who was driving the bus lifted the hood, agents scrambled out to work on the locks and break in. Onlookers across the street could not see them behind the bus. Once the agents were in the target building, the bus drove off. When the agents had finished installing electronic bugs, the bus returned to pick them up. But the bus whizzed past two inebriated customers from the bar who were waiting at a nearby bus stop. When the bus stopped in front of the business, the two angry patrons ran for the bus and jumped in. Since many of the agents were from different offices, everyone assumed at first that the two men were part of their operation. "We get a couple of blocks away. We start peeling off our equipment," says FBI agent Louis E. Griever, who was on the TacOps team for 12 years. "We've all got weapons on and radio gear, and these two guys are kind of sitting there going, 'What the hell?' They start ringing the bell. Ding, ding. They want to get off. Ding, ding." Now the bus driver, who was from the local office, was not a very good bus driver. I think he practiced for like 20 minutes driving this bus. He was knocking over garbage cans when he made turns. He yells back, "Hey, quit playing with the bell. I'm having a hard enough time driving the bus." Other agents on the bus began to realize that the two men ringing to get off were not with the FBI after all. Before each job, all the agents meet each other, and now it seemed clear that these two were unwitting imposters. "One of our guys got up, and he just happened to have a shotgun hanging on the strap on his back," Griever says. He walks over to them and goes, "Do we know you?" Now, Griever says, they're really ringing that bell. Ding, 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 ding. And we realize that these guys are not with us. So we yell up, "Hey, Phil, stop the bus. We got a couple of riders here." The driver turned around, took one look at the patrons, and realized they were not agents. Swearing, he pulled over and opened the doors. "They got out, and we never heard a word from them," Griever says. "They had no clue what was going on. They just happened to get on the wrong bus." Back in 1992, Griever, who has blue eyes and a reddish buzz cut, had never heard of the Tactical Operations Section. But his supervisor in the Jackson, Mississippi field office, Billups Bill Allen, asked if he would like to join it. At the time, Griever had been in the FBI 4 years. he was expecting to be transferred to New York or Los Angeles. About what TacOps does, Alan was cagey. Instead, he put him in touch with Mike McDevitt, a fellow former Marine.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.